So, hello everyone. My name is Claudia Sendler. I work at the Leibniz Institute for Agricultural Landscape Research and I'm based in Münchenberg, Germany. And I'm going to start with an introduction into our work. And as Zoe already said, the topic of the webinar is networking for the landscape, the potential of collaborative governance in addressing institutional misfit and the provision of ecosystem services. So the research I'm going to present relates to a research project entitled CP3, and CP3 stands for Civil Public Private Partnerships, and the full project title is Collaborative Governance Approaches for Policy Innovation to Enhance Biodiversity and Ecosystem Services Delivery in Agricultural Landscapes. Three, also included in the project title, CP3 is kind of our magic number because we had a 3-year project duration. We started in May 2015 and our project will officially end this month. We also were 3 partners in the project consortium, the Leibniz Center of Agricultural Landscape Research in Germany, Wageningen University and Research based in the Netherlands, and from Austria, the Organization for International Dialogue and Conflict Management based in Vienna. Because we were only 3 project partners, our team was rather small. So it's Lenny van Bussel and Dolph de Groot from Wageningen University, then Angela Meyer and Gregor Gürsch from the Organization for International Dialogue and Conflict Management from Austria. And from Germany, it's myself and Claudia Bethwell and Ulrich Stachow. And we were also lucky that some master students got very interested in the topic of our research. So we had 3 master students in the Netherlands and also 3 in Germany. And we, CP3 was one of 10 sister projects funded from in the Biodiversa FATSA JPI call from 2013-2014. And each partner had a different funding agency. For Germany, it was Federal Ministry of Education and Research. In the Netherlands, it was NWO. And for Austria, for the Austrian partner, it was FWF. Then each partner brought one case study into the project. And this, the important thing is that all case studies are protection areas, either completely or in part. Then in our research, we related to the theory of institutional misfit. What does this mean? So if you have a natural system and a certain environmental problem, for instance, you want to manage population, like a population of an endangered species in the natural system, and then you have in the social system different administrative units, for example, you have the protection area and you have adjacent counties, or it can also be different countries, doesn't really matter. Then to really address the problem properly, you need collaboration between these administrative units, because you need an approach that really fits to the ecosystem services and ecosystems you would like to manage. So the challenge is to find a governance solution that really fits to your environmental problem. And when we talk about institutional misfit, there can be different types of misfit. In the literature, there are 3 types mentioned. Spatial misfit would be if you you would like to manage this this environmental problem, which is spread in the spatial context. Then you need really to have a governance solution that really manages the problem in its whole spatial extent. Then a second type of misfit can be related to temporal issues. So this is the case, for instance, if you need different management at different times. For instance, if the species migrates and you need a different management, like in winter and in summer, for instance. And temporal misfit can also occur if you have a governance solution in place that is very short term, but to really address the environmental problem properly, you need something long term. So you have an agri environmental scheme that offers 5-year contracts to farmers, but what you really need is like something that lasts for 30 years. The last type of misfit is called functional misfit. This is related to governance gaps. So if you have really a problem when no governance solution is in place right now, but this is one type of functional misfit. Another one relates if you have different approaches, for instance, like each of the different administrative units, they have a governance solution in place, but they are not aligned to each other. So they partly can cancel each other out or are contradictory to each other. Then the question of institutional misfit is highly relevant in regard to protection areas, because protection areas get designated because of environmental characteristics of the landscape, and they almost never nicely overlay with administrative units, which you can see in this slide. This is maps out all the our different case studies, and you see the light green areas are the protection areas, and you see that they go cross boundary to different administrative units. For example, in Germany, they grow cross boundary 3 different counties. Then this raises the question how you can fix misfit or address misfit. And there are usually, or typically, there are 3 different recipes how you can address an environmental problem. You can use hierarchical approaches, which means command and control, laws and regulations. Then the second one is market-based or financial approaches, like payments for ecosystem services or agri-environmental schemes. Or you can, the third one is collaboration, or sometimes it's also referred to as community-based governance or network governance. And in hierarchical approaches, it's not voluntary. You put a restriction on someone, and if someone is not in compliance with the different laws and regulations, there would be punishments. So these are called stick instruments. So like in this case, it's a baseball bat, but you try to enforce certain rules, and if someone does not comply, he's punished. Then the second one is voluntary. It's a group of voluntary approaches where you offer a nice incentive, like this carrot, and you try to change the behavior of people by making this very attractive to them. So they will, for example, sign up for a certain agri environmental scheme. And the last one is based on that the actors really are convinced, or they really see the necessity that a problem needs addressing, and the collaboration is because the actors are really convinced that something needs to be done, and this is why they cooperate with each other. And in CP3, we are really focusing on this collaboration. In reality, you often have a mix of different approaches, so you have hybrid solutions. And also sometimes it's the case that a governance approach starts as something new and then it develops into another type. So you can have something that first is a collaborative initiative and then it develops, for example, into an agri-environmental scheme, which is more market-based. And in regard to protection area, you have always different layers of governance approaches, because designation of protection areas is always a hierarchical approach, because it comes with a lot of restrictions for the local people, but voluntary approaches like market-based and collaborative approaches, they become more important too. Then In terms of these different governance approaches, hierarchies, markets, and collaboration, different actors become important. So if you have hierarchies, it's mostly public actors. If we talk about market-based approaches, it's mostly private for-profit actors. And if we talk about collaborative approaches, also civil society actors are part of the solution. So then when you look at hybrid solutions, you can have all sorts of collaboration. You can have public-private partnerships, civil-private partnerships, civil-public partnerships, and of course, civil-public-private partnerships, which is again the name of our project, and it's also the focus of our analysis. And when you come from only hierarchical solutions where public actors are most important, you talk about government. And when you also have the other actors involved, you talk about governance. So against this tendency that there is a shift from government to more governance, where you also have this other actors, more private actors and civil society actors involved, our research question is, with a focus on collaborative governance, are they better suited to address and mitigate issues of misfit? And the challenge is that collaborative governance approaches, or existing collaborative governance approaches, are very heterogeneous. So they summarize a lot of very different approaches. So it's not really known what are the basic characteristics or features. And so our aim was to really do an in-depth analysis of examples of existing collaborative governance in terms of who are the relevant actors, what are their roles, how do they interact with each other to address the problem, what are their motives to get involved, how influential are they in decision-making, and what kind of benefits do they get out of their involvement? And how do these characteristics relate to misfit issues? And later on, we selected, for this webinar, we selected three different governance approaches, which we will introduce to you later on. And they represent different hybrid solutions. So we have one that is really a purely collaborative approach, then one that is more co-management between public and civil society and private actors, and another one which is like a total hybrid between these three types. For our investigation, we used a method mix. We used literature review and document analysis, also participant observation while sitting in on different events with the stakeholders. We also organized our own workshops and focus group discussions with stakeholders. We did a lot of interviews. And for this network analysis, we used a specific tool called NetMap. And we also combined it with GIS analysis and mapping, particularly for ecosystem service mapping. We also developed a tool called Mapscape that we used for participatory GIS. And to just give you an idea about one of the methods which we used for the network analysis, I wanted to show you some slides on this NetMap tool. And this is one example of such a net map, which we co-create in an interview session together with a stakeholder. And it asks for different informations. For instance, the first one is about the actors. So on the post-its, you have all relevant actors that play a role in the different collaborative initiatives. Then you also ask about the links between these actors. For example, how do they exchange information, or how do they exchange resources like money, or how is that there, which actors have a relationship of trust, or which actors are in conflict with each other. Then the third type of information is about the motives. So for example, this actor is included because he wants to improve his image, and he also is involved because of economic reasons. And these motives, they are not predefined, So you take them as the actors tell them to you. And we also ask about the influence each actor has. So, and we use stacks for that. So the higher the stack, the more influential is one actor. So this one, for example, is very influential. And we also use the same principles for asking about the benefits. So this one is has 5 in both cases and would be more influential and would get more benefits out of the arrangement than, for instance, this actor who has only 3. Then once you have this information, you can use professional software like UCINET or Netwar to analyze the actors network. And this is just an example that shows the information flow for one of the approaches we looked at. And the colors symbolize the different main interests of the actors. This one was more conservation based. This one was more provisioning service. The main interest was provisioning service. This was also other ecosystem services like regulating and biodiversity protection. And then you also have a group of actors that has mixed interest. And when it comes to the motivations, it's always like there is not only one certain motivation that drives an actor to be engaged in the initiative, but it's always a mixture. And you, when you group these motives, you have always self-regarding or self-interested motives, which is, for example, for economic reasons or because they have a certain mandate, so they need to fulfill their duty or they want to improve their image. But all actors also have this other regarding motives, which is to do something for the community, to do something for the environment, or to preserve culture and tradition. And this is what really is important to hold everything together. So the actors do have self-regarding interests, but they always have also this other regarding interests. What you can also generate from the NetMap information you collected is how influential an actor is. So you can create this influence benefit matrix, and here these actors, they are really have a high influence, and these are called decision makers. And then you also have a group of actors that are not so influential, but some of them have a very very high benefits. So these are the actors who can lose a lot if you, they have very high stakes. So if the decision is not in their favor, they really can lose a lot. And when you do the analysis, you can this way you can see if also like the decision takers are involved in the approaches, which is the case in this example. Then based on the analysis of our cases and also based on the literature review, we can summarize specific strengths of collaborative governance approaches. One is that often they arise because of misfit issue, because, for example, government retreats, and so there is a governance gap, and then an initiative forms to address this misfit. And typically, all actors relevant to the magnitude of the problem can engage. Usually, these initiatives are open to everyone, so everyone can get involved. And so they allow for more inclusive decision making. As I showed with this interest benefit matrix, also stakeholders who have not, who are not so influential can be part. And so they get included in the decision making. Then they help to mobilize all relevant resources, because you can include the local knowledge of extra. And sometimes this is also important for leveraging extra funding when you make a link to a very influential actor. Doesn't have to be a local actor, can someone from the upper levels. And also, very importantly, they sometimes use voluntary work. So they can draw from manpower, that people, just because people spend time or give time to the initiative. Then typically they are also more flexible, which allows for learning effects, so they can adapt their measures and their management over time and also create space for innovation. And very often they constitute tailor-made solutions for very complex local frame conditions. Also because this has to do with local knowledge, of course, because they include the local knowledge about the landscape into their decision making. And because people interact a lot, they create social capital and which builds up trust between the actors. And this is very a good thing because it lowers control costs, because you have this social pressure and people just do what they promised to do. And this is also relevant because of the protection areas. Protection areas often get designated in areas of national interest, but through this collaborative governance approaches, they can help to refocus on local demands of ecosystem services like flood protection, and not only on this higher scale interests. And they can provide more durable solutions, or at least they last as long as they are needed. But besides these advantages, they can also have certain limitations. Although they are in principle open to everyone, important stakeholders can choose not to engage, or they are excluded on purpose. Also, because they decisions are built on consensus, they need enough time. So sometimes actors get impatient, and important actors can get disappointed, and then they drop out of the arrangement, although they are really important for the initiative. And because people have so divided interests, they need a lot of they need to put a lot of effort into communication. So they need constant active management and communication to, due to the very different interests. They also often struggle to have enough and continuous resources. So many of them their financing is based on projects which have a limited duration. And so this is really for continuous management, they have to apply for new funds, which sometimes is difficult. And also sometimes leadership depends on certain key individuals, and when they drop out of the arrangement, then this initiative is really vulnerable because there's no one who can really step in and fill this role. Then you can also have the case that some actors, they are very involved in different functions in other networks. So they sometimes have different hats, and you cannot say for sure on behalf of what kind of agenda they really act. So they can have hidden agendas. It can also be a positive thing because they see links between the different networks, and so they can say, okay, we need, for example, a certain type of machinery, and because he's involved in the other network, he sees the links that someone has exactly this machinery. So it's a plus minus thing. Then sometimes they can have least denominator solutions. This is because decisions are based on consensus. So sometimes the actors arrive at a solution that everyone can agree on, but it's just not the optimal solution. And often they are small solutions because trust is needed. The groups needs to stay smaller so that everyone can really relate to everyone else. And it just gets harder when the group becomes too large. There are some examples of international collaborative governance approaches, and they can work, but still they need to meet in person from time to time. And also often these initiatives have no official decision-making power. They have no mandate or authority, so they can just voice concern and do lobbying. And this is just to show the references in case someone really wants to delve more into the details of everything. And this was the first part. Thank you very much for listening. And I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Claudia. We actually have a very interesting question. We're passing to Miguel. So what can be done if influential decision-making stakeholders do not engage?
So actually, in the examples we analyzed, that was never the case. So we always had, I think that's the basic difference between hierarchical approaches, where you have like the official decision makers, the administrations who have the mandate to do decisions, and this collaborative initiatives, that's really one of their key advantages. They always include like stakeholders who are less influential. I guess if you look hard, you could find examples, but we did not.